error in making the right decision while planning fluid management is something which is common. And in one of the recent literature, they said that one out of five patients suffered from some of the complications due to inappropriate fluid administration. And therefore, it is essential that we provide adequate fluid administration and proper fluid administration. Planning fluid administration for clinician is a burdensome. So today I will discuss some of the important aspect by which all of us will get basic information how to prepare prescription for given patient. There are so many pills available in market, and therefore the question arises that when to give IV fluid, what to give, how much to give, and when not to give. This is something which is very, very important. Right amount, right fluid, and right time, if we can offer, then we will get the best result. So today's talk, I will be discussing in some four different categories. First, we will go for the normal requirement, that what is the normal requirement of the fluid? Normal requirement of the fluid is 30 ml per kg per day. We also need sodium, we also need potassium, and very important that if patient is not able to take oral fluid, minimum 100 gram of dextrose should be administered in any form to such patient. So this is something which is very basic thing. Now, when it comes to understanding fluid, then we need to know that out of all fluids available, which fluid is rich in sodium, which fluid is rich in potassium, out of this fluid, which is the physiological fluid, and why we need to all these things? Because with this, we select right kind of the fluid. The first and foremost is the sodium. Sodium is something which is very important. Normal requirement of the sodium is 100 milliequivalent, or we can say 6 gram. And now, after understanding this basic thing, if we look at the different IV fluids, then the sodium content of these IV fluids are variable depending upon the type of fluid which we are using. Now, out of all fluid, normal saline has maximum sodium, and that is 154 milliequivalent. 1 gram of salt provides 17 milliequivalent of sodium. And when we say that normal saline or DNS has 154 milliequivalent of sodium, that means this fluid, 1 liter, has 9 gram of the salt. Ringer's lactate has 7 gram of salt roughly, and all isolates are comparatively poor in sodium. In some of the special case, we use 3% NaCl, which is available in 100 ml, and that contains 3 gram of salt. So when we want to select the fluid, if we want to provide more sodium, then the fluid which are preferred and rich in sodium are DNS and NS, which has 154 milliequivalent or 9 gram of salt. And Ringer's lactate has 130 milliequivalent or roughly 7 gram of salt. Rest other fluids are not rich in sodium, and therefore, when we want to provide sodium, these are the preferred fluid. Likewise, some of the patient, we feel that no, we want to give more potassium. So question arises that out of commercially available fluid, which are the potassium-containing fluid? Answer is that the rich, all isolates are rich in potassium. Maximum is with isolate M, then comes isolate P and isolate G. But practically, for day-to-day purpose, we don't use isolate fluids. And therefore, if we need to provide potassium, then we have to give it in separate way. So, nutshell, the maximum potassium lies with isolate M, that is 35 milliequivalent, and the fluid like Ringer's lactate has just 4 milliequivalent of potassium, and therefore If we are giving fluid like ringous lactate, normal saline, or DNS, it is important to see that we provide them adequate amount of potassium. Now, when we look at the IV fluid, we need to know that what fluid contains, but we need to know at even other side of the coin that what fluid does not contain. So, in patient where we don't want to give glucose, dextrose, what are the options of fluid available to us? They are saline, zinc, and malate. These are the fluids which are free of glucose. When we don't want to give sodium, only fluid available are dextrose containing fluid like 5%, 10%, 20%, 25%. And all isolates are comparatively low in sodium. And when it comes to potassium free fluid, then saline, all dextrose containing fluid, dextrose saline are fluid which are potassium free. So these are the other part of the fluid which we need to look at while selecting IV fluid. Now, coming to individual IV fluid, that what are their characteristics and why do we select one fluid over the other? Now, 5% dextrose. This 1 liter fluid contains 50 gram of glucose. Normal minimum requirement, as we discussed, is 100 gram. So even if you provide 1 gram of dextrose, 1 liter of dextrose, then the calories which will be available to patient will be inadequate. Second thing, that this is less useful fluid in day-to-day practice because it provides only water, no electrolytes, and dextrose is there, but that is inadequate to meet with the normal requirement. So in day-to-day practice, using sparingly as a vehicle for some of the IV drugs, in hypernatremia, it can be done. And if patient is NBM and we want to provide only water but no electrolytes, in that case, to prevent starvation ketosis, this is the fluid which is used. We need to remember that because of lack of electrolyte, this is hypotonic fluid. Osmolality is less and therefore it carries risk of cerebral edema. It's not good for resuscitation. Larger amount can lead to hyponatremia. And if co-administered with the blood, then there are chances of hemolysis. So 5% take-home message is that use sparingly because it does not provide salt, does not provide any adequate calories and no other electrolytes like potassium. Now, when it comes to isotonic saline, normal saline or 0.9% saline, this is the salt-rich fluid amongst routinely used IV fluid, it is the richest source of the sodium. Now, when it is the richest source of sodium, how do we use it and when should we use it in day-to-day practice? This is a fluid which is very valuable and used for the treatment of vomiting, hypovolemic shock, metabolic halitosis, patient with hypovolemic hyponatremia, and diabetic ketoacidosis. These are the indications where normal saline is preferred IV fluid. But we need to keep in mind that 1 liter contains 9 gram, 154 milliequivalent of sodium, which is 1.5 times than the normal requirement of the sodium. And therefore, there is a large sodium load with the saline. And therefore, if patient has NSARCA because of the renal failure, congestive heart failure, cirrhosis, or patient has severe hypertension, then this fluid should be avoided or should be given cautiously in low volume. Now, coming to ringous lactate, this is also known as the balanced fluid, or it is most known as the most physiological fluid. Why ringous lactate is considered to be the most physiological fluid? Answer is that if you look at it, sodium, potassium, chloride, lactate, which gets converted into bicarbonate by liver and osmolality, all these electrolytes are matching with that of the normal plasma. And therefore, this is considered to be the most physiological fluid. Now, important to remember that like saline, it does not provide calories. There is no magnesium, there is no phosphorus. When we say that physiological fluid, then these are the three things which should be present are lacking, and therefore when we are using this fluid, we should especially keep in mind that calories will need to be supplemented separately. Now, in day-to-day practice, when we look at this fluid, what are the benefits? The large volume can be infused rapidly without risk of electrolyte imbalance. This is something which is very, very important. And therefore, in certain conditions like cholera or burns, where we need to give fluid in volume such as 4 or 5 liters over the day, this fluid can be given without any hesitation because there is no risk of electrolyte imbalance. Second thing, it's fairly rich in sodium and therefore expand intravascular volume, so good for the shock. Additional very important thing, that lactate in RL get metabolized to bicarbonate in liver, and therefore it provides bicarbonate, and therefore it corrects metabolic acidosis, which is present in hypovolemic, sick, septic patient. So these are the benefits of the Ringer's lactate. And in day-to-day practice, where should we use Ringer's lactate? Answer is that it's a good fluid for resuscitation. It's a fluid of choice for surgical patient, intraoperatively, as well as postoperatively. In clinical common conditions like diarrhea, burns, fracture, this is an excellent fluid. Diabetic ketoacidosis, it can be used when there is more acidosis. And as for the irrigation of body cavity and bone, because it's physiological, it won't harm, and therefore it is something which is very good. In the same way as saline, as 7 gram or 130 milliequivalent of sodium content of Ringer's lactate make it sodium rich. So with enasarca or uncontrolled hypertension, this should not be given or should be given cautiously. And it should not be given even in case of metabolic alkalosis or in head injury. So this was a basic platform that what are the common fluids, how do we compare it as far as the sodium and potassium is concerned, and what is the strength and limitation of different IV fluids. Now, before going to clinical part and last part, one important part is that how do we calculate administration of the fluid? Suppose we are in OPD and we started IV fluid at 10 o'clock in the morning, and we wish that by 1 o'clock, by the time our OPD is about to be over, we want to finish the 500 ml of IV fluid administered. Then how do we calculate administration of IV fluid? This is something which is very useful for everyone, because infusion pump and everything is not within reach and is not possible at most of the places. So we have a beautiful, simple idea, simple rule for the calculation. This is for routine IV set. Now, if we want to calculate for 24 hours, suppose we want to give it for 12 hours or 8 hours, then how do we calculate it? It's simple. We have rule of 10. What is this rule of 10 for 24 hours? It's simple, that fluid to be administered in 24 hours in liter multiplied by 10 is equal to drop rate per minute. If you want to give 1 liter, keep 10 drops. If you want to give 2 liters, keep 20 drops. If you want to give 3 liters, keep 30 drops. But most of you will really think that no, we don't administer round the clock. We want to deliver it in, say, 6 hours or 8 hours. Answer is simple, that if we want to give it for 8 hours, that means it is 24 hours, means 3 liters. So if we want to give 3 liters, keep 30 drops. If you want to complete fluid in 6 hours, say 1 liter of fluid in 6 hours, that means in 24 hours, it will be 4 liters. So just keep 40 drops. So this is something which is very, very simple and easy to execute. But other formula, this is rule of 10 is for 24 hours. But all of you would like to know the rule for 1 hour, and that is rule of four. So if you want to calculate that within 60 minutes, how much fluid should be administered and how to calculate, answer is that determine the volume to be administered. Presume that we want to give 100 ml in 1 hour. Divided by 4 is equal to drop rate per minute. So if you want to give 100 ml, it will be 25 drops per minute. If you want to give 200 ml per hour, it should be 50 drops per minute. And if you want to give fast dilute fluid, say 500 ml in just 1 hour, then just give 125 drops. So this rule of four for family physician is more important, because it's not hospitalized patient we want to give outdoor. Say in 3 hours, we want to finish this much of the volume, and then accordingly you can calculate. So I will again repeat that rule of four is simple. Volume in ml per hour divided by 4 will give us the drop rate per minute. If you want to give 60 ml, 60 ml divided by 4 will amount to 15 drops per minute. So this is something which is useful. And sometimes in pediatric patients, we use micro drip IVC. And for that, calculation is something which is very, very simple. That volume in ml per hour is equal to micro drop per minute. So if you want to give 50 ml, 50 micro drops. If you want to give 70 ml per hour, keep 70 micro drops. If you want to give 30 ml per hour, keep 30 micro drops. So it's something which is very, very simple and very, very easy. Now coming to the last part, and that is coming to common clinical disorder, where how do we really plan in management? So we need to provide specific treatment considering specific underlying etiology. Three of the most common problems I will be discussing: vomiting, diarrhea, and hypotension. Now, vomiting is a condition where there is a loss of upper GI secretion, gastric juice, and this will lead to dehydration. Loss of hydrochloric acid will lead to alkalosis. Loss of potassium will lead to hypokalemia. So, patient with vomiting will have hypokalemic, low chloride, hypochloremic. Bicarbonate will increase, that will be metabolic alkalosis with deficit. Now, if we are dealing with vomiting, then what should be the IV fluid which we should prefer? Answer is that when we select, when we want to give IV fluid for vomiting, isotonic saline is the preferred IV fluid. This isotonic saline will take care of all abnormalities which occur with upper GI loss because of the profuse vomiting. Some of the patients will have potassium deficit, and isotonic saline does not have any potassium. So in patient with vomiting, where we are supplementing isotonic saline, either we need to give oral potassium in terms of fruit juice or coconut water, or if the hypokalemia is severe and patient is unable to take oral potassium containing fluid or diet, add KCL in pint. The KCL injection is available in 10 ml ampoule, which contains 20 ml equivalent of potassium, and optimum maximum amount of potassium which can be safely added is 1 ampoule 10 ml in 500 ml of normal saline. So if you feel that your patient is having hypokalemia, then in 1 liter of saline you can add 2 ampoule of KCL and you can administer, then it will take care of the hypokalemia along with other correction. So take home message: vomiting, start with saline. If patient is hypoglycemic, then you can start also with the dextrosaline. Now, second most common problem which we see in day-to-day practice is the diarrhea. There are two important abnormalities which occurs in diarrheal patient. Number one, diarrheal fluid is rich in bicarbonate, so it leads to metabolic acidosis. Second thing, it is rich in potassium, and therefore it leads to hypokalemia. So patient will have hypokalemic, hyperchloremic, metabolic acidosis with fluid deficit. How do we treat it? Answer is that 90% of the patient will be able to get adequate fluid and electrolyte when we use ORS. ORS, everybody, all of us are properly educating family of the patient that take 1 liter of bottle, 8 total content of the ORS in it, mix it and give it. This is something which is very, very important, because otherwise patient family will feel that we will have a glass of water, we will add 1 spoon of ORS and then give it to the patient, which is inappropriate. So this is something which is very important. And when diarrhea is profuse, there is hypotension, and we need to administer IV fluid. Very, very essential is that the fluid preferred, fluid selected, is ringus lactate. Small group of patients may require additional potassium chloride or additional bicarbonate. But by and large, ringus lactate has small amount of potassium. It has lactate, which gets converted into bicarbonate. And therefore, there will be sodium, there will be potassium, there will be bicarbonate, there will be fluid. And therefore, when there is diarrhea, ringus lactate. Okay? So, very, very important take-home message is that we don't go for electrolyte estimates. If we have vomiting, start with isotonic saline. And if we have diarrhea, start with ringus lactate when ORS replacement is inadequate in even patient. Now, coming to the last part of today's discussion, and that is fluid resuscitation, that is the treatment of hypotension with IV fluid, where timely proper treatment is most rewarding. Selection of the right fluid is life-saving. And when it comes to this discussion, we have fluid like 5% dextrose, we have crystalloids, we have colloid in blood. So the question arises that which fluid should be given and why? Answer is that the selection of the fluid determines on ability of the given fluid to expand intravascular compartment. So the fluid which expands intravascular compartment in greater way increases blood pressure fast. Now the question arises that suppose if we give 5% dextrose, how much will be the expected rough expansion of the intravascular compartment? Out of 1000 ml, will it be 500? Will it be 600? Will it be 400 ml? Answer is something which is surprising and shocking, that when you give 1 liter of 5% dextrose, out of that, only 83 ml will be retained inside the intravascular compartment. Sir, we have given 1 liter of fluid, but blood pressure is not improving. Physician may think of septicemia. Surgeon may think of underlying abdominal leak or something, but it may be improper selection of IV fluid. As 5% is only water, it will be distributed in all compartment equally, and therefore in an intravascular compartment, only 83 ml will be retained, and therefore ability of the 5% dextrose to raise the blood pressure is very, very poor, and therefore is not preferred in patients with hypotension. Now, why? Why isotonic saline and ringus lactate are preferred? Answer is that the distribution, this most fluid is salt rich fluid, and salt is ECF distributed, and therefore saline and ringus lactate will be distributed only in extracellular, that is in the ICF and intravascular compartment. And therefore, out of 1 liter, roughly 300 ml will be distributed inside the intravascular compartment. And therefore, ability to raise the blood pressure with saline and ringus lactate will be better, much better than 5% dextrose, and therefore is the preferred IV fluid. But why? Why colloid and blood are most potent fluid to raise the blood pressure? Answer is that the distribution is 100% in intravascular compartment. If you administer 300 ml, the 300 ml will be retained inside the intravascular compartment, and therefore, with smaller volume, the expansion of the intravascular volume will be larger. Not only that, the fluid like 20% albumin is hypertonic, will shift fluid from other compartment into intravascular compartment, and rise in the intravascular compartment will be even greater than the volume infused. And therefore, when we are in crisis, when blood pressure, we are unable to get response with the saline in ringus lactate, that's the time when we use blood product or when we use colloid. So, take home message is that the dextrose 5%, just 10% in intravascular compartment, not good. Normal saline in ringus lactate, roughly 25% will remain in the intravascular compartment. So, fairly potent and preferred fluid, and blood and colloids 100% in intravascular compartment, and therefore most preferred IV fluid when we want to rapidly raise the blood pressure. So, take home message is that look at the underlying problem, select right kind of the fluid. Ringus lactate and saline are most preferred. Colloid and blood are most effective. Never use 5% dextrose or isolate. When we give 5%, when by mistake somebody gives 5% dextrose, they will say, sir, blood pressure is not improving. But now patient has become drowsy. Why? Because it's sodium-free IV fluid. And in patient of combined loss of salt and water, when potassium, when sodium-free fluid is administered, it may precipitate hyponatremia, and that may lead to voltage sensorium. So, don't give 5% dextrose. Don't give all isolates for initial resuscitation fluid because of two reasons. Number one, they are salt poor, so ability to expand blood vessel intravascular compartment will be poor and potassium rich. So, in oliguric patient, large amount of potassium infusion can lead to hyperkalemia, which is harmful. So this is something which is very important. Now, sometimes we think that, yes, saline is good. But instead of saline, if we give dextrose saline for resuscitation, say we want to give 1 liter in, say, 1 hour or so. So fast administration of fluid is required. If instead of saline, if we give dextrose saline, patient may require some calories that will be provided by DNS. So, question arises that can we use DNS instead of NS for fluid resuscitation? Answer is no. No. This simple logic does not stand true. When we give rapid dextrose infusion, it will lead to hyperglycemia. When blood glucose increases, it will act as an osmotic diuresis, and that will increase the urine output. And when in patient with shock, urine output is good, it gives us two impressions. Number one, that yes, patient is responding very well to our therapy, urine output is good, and therefore, second thing which comes is that slow down rate of infusion. So, patient is hypovolemic, and you try to reduce the rate of administration, which is harmful, and therefore, take home message is that avoid all dextrose containing IV fluid for initial fluid of resuscitation. The best options are ringus lactate and saline. So, trend of using IV fluid, 2002 conclusion is what? Crystalloid is preferred over colloid for fluid resuscitation. Normal saline and ringus lactate are preferred. So, which is best? Both are good, as we discussed, but hypotension means normal saline is already established in our mind from last almost 3, 4 decades, because normal saline is the first fluid of choice for almost last one decade. So what is right? Answer is that no. Hypotension means not normal saline. Hypotension means Ringer's lactate. Hypotension means balanced fluid. So whenever patient present to you with hypotension, change your habit. Don't start with normal saline. Start with Ringer's lactate. It is better. It is beneficial in many ways. So resuscitation means Ringer's lactate. Always use it first. So should we discard normal saline in patient with a patient where we don't need to do resuscitation? Altogether, should we stop using normal saline? No. It's like Prime Minister Narendra Modi and Amit Shah. They are complementary to each other. So is the case here that normal saline is preferred over Ringer's lactate in patient with vomiting, in patient with metabolic alkalosis, hypovolemic hyponatremia, diabetic ketoacidosis, brain injury, and when there is co-administration with the blood. So take home message is that when patient presents to you with the hypotension, start with the Ringer's lactate. But if patient has vomiting, if the sodium is low, if patient has metabolic alkalosis, if patient has diabetic ketoacidosis, brain injury, or co-administration with blood is required, don't give Ringer's lactate, start with normal saline. So select judiciously, rightly, Ringer's lactate, and in some case, normal saline. This is something which is important. I would like to thank all my friends for supporting my educational activity. This practical guidelines on fluid therapy has crossed the sale of 1 lakh copies. And I would like to request you to support Mission to Prevent and Care Kidney Disease. We have kidneyeducation.com website. In kidneyeducation.com website, it's a website in maximum, that is 37 languages. This, it's a proud of India because it received World Record Award for e-book in highest number of languages. 200-page kidney book is available in 25 international languages and in 12 Indian languages through the website in form of PDF and WhatsApp, totally free. This website received more than 7 crore hits in 120 months. It's a proud of India. And on this WhatsApp number, if you will send message, you can get kidney 200-page kidney book free in any of the 37 languages which we have. We have prepared this 37 language with the help of strong global support. We have a team of more than 100 nephrologists out of India, most of the people, and everybody has contributed to prepare this website in multiple languages. This activity is blessed, and that's the reason it is going high, and is and lot of patients are benefited with the same. With this, I would like to end my talk. We can have question answer, whatever is required. Thank you. Thank you very much.